Tanya Head was just one of 19 people who had been above the point of impact in the South Tower, lived to tell about it. After being badly burned, Tanya witnessed the decapitation of her assistant before coming across a dying man who begged her to deliver his wedding ring to his wife. Her own survival, she said, was made possible by the thoughts of beautiful white dress she would be wearing for her fiancé Dave on their wedding day. Soon after, this woman would learn that Dave, who had been working in the North Tower, didn't make it. Despite that devastating loss, Tanya became a beacon of hope. She lobbied to have survivors invited to annual 9/11 commemorations, have them represented in the 9/11 Museum, even gave Rudy Giuliani, Michael Bloomberg, a tour of Ground Zero. But Tanya, you see, had a very dark secret. She wasn't even in the United States on September 11th. It was all a lie. Robin Fisher and Angelo Guglielmo Jr. wrote about Tanya's extraordinary deception. Their new book is entitled The Woman Who Wasn't There. Angelo, who'd been friends with Tanya, told me about how they first met.
The second we met, she told me her story. I cried and...
You cried?
Yeah. I mean, and she only had really like 70 seconds to tell me the story. It was just barely a minute. And, you know, we became friends right after that. And then she asked me to do a documentary based on her group.
Robin, to you, I mean, Tanya had really emerged as a very well-known name within the 9/11 survivors community.
Yeah.
She wasn't just a survivor. I mean, she was, what, the president of the Survivors Network?
Yes.
What else?
She was. I mean, she was everything. She was the ultimate survivor. She was a widow. She was a victim. She was the leader. She was everything on 9/11.
When you hear the details of her story and her fiancé and the ring that she brought to the man after she got out of the South Tower, I mean, did you ever stop and question any of the story and her personality?
Oh.
Describe it.
Well, you know, she had a personality that was not unlike a movie star. It was magnetic. She had a magnetism. She didn't have empirical, like, physical beauty. But what she did have was this light around her that connected you to her immediately. So she was able to walk into a room and just command presence. All eyes were on her. And, I mean, we connected to her right away. And so did the press, so did the people in the 9/11 community. It was very hard because, as Robin said, you know, she represented a widow and a hero and almost everything that 9/11 came to represent.
So never at any point in time you said, Tanya, I'm not so sure about you.
Well, you know, it's a strange thing. You know, she's sitting in front of your camera and you're interviewing her and, you know, she's bearing her soul. And not for a second did I believe that she was anything more than an authentic 9/11 survivor. Her story changed. You know, she was a widow. She said she had a fiance, then a husband, then it went back to fiance.
Some holes in the resume.
Sure. Merrill Lynch, Morgan Stanley, back to Merrill Lynch. And you just said to yourself, well, she's so traumatized that she can't keep her facts straight. And that was common of a lot of survivors. So, you know, you just, every type of detection you had of her, you overruled because of her trauma.
You talk about interviewing her for the documentary and she's telling these stories and you would never think for a second to question that. But who questioned it, who did a little fact checking, was the New York Times.
The New York Times.
So this piece
right.
comes out and you come to realize that this good friend, who, you know, I'm sure she bared her soul to you and vice versa, you
sure.
find out this was all a ruse. Are you in shock? Do you think it's a joke?
Oh, you know, it's hard to believe, and it's hard to wrap your head around at first. You know, you have to keep reminding yourself that she was lying, because it was, ironically, the deception that didn't seem real. And then, after you sort of come out of that shock, it sort of starts to make sense. The canceled appointments, the disappearances, the inconsistencies in stories and emotions, the emotional outbreaks, you start to say, wow, all that mystery that we couldn't figure out now is adding up.
Did you ever have a chance to see her finally once this all came out and say, who are you and why?
Well, you know, against all odds, in a city of 8 million people, I ran into her on the street just days after the 10th anniversary. And the survivors really were still suffering at what she had done. I mean, the shockwaves were through the survivor community for years to come.
Wow.
And, I asked her, how could you come to New York after the 10th anniversary?
How dare you?
Yeah, how dare you? And don't you feel a thing for the people that you've hurt? Because it just boggled my mind that there was no contrition, there was no apology, there was no
No apology?
No.
Not once.
Still not. There was no effort to ease their suffering, which they clearly were so doing. You know, so it was incredible.
Who is she, and where is she now?
She is. She's a very wealthy woman. Her family's very wealthy from Barcelona. She travels all over Europe. She goes from Barcelona. She pops into Manhattan. Seems to be living the high life. I believe, at least her therapist told me, that if she's not scamming someone right now, she will definitely do it again. And she even fooled her own therapist.